your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given unto him. And verse 6, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavers is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. As it regards the life of the believer, the Lord never ceases to desire that we continually grow in the grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the Lord's, it's the Holy Spirit's desire that we continually be changed from moment to moment, from day to day, from week to week, month to month. That we never remain the same, that we never stay stagnant, that we never remain where we are. Amen. It's the desire of the Holy Spirit, and the Apostle Paul himself would lay it out in Philippians chapter 3, but it's the desire of the Holy Spirit that we not look backward, but that we continually be looking forward, continually be pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And in order for us to grow, in order for us to grow more dependent, to grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, then something must happen. And that happening must be that we have to come to the realization of the lack that is in our lives. Mm-hmm. And whether you know it or not, whether you've experienced this or not, you will in this process as a Christian, you will experience the fact that we do not come to that realization easily. Much like the Laodicean church, our hearts and our minds a lot of times I'm full, I'm clothed, and I'm in absolute need of nothing. I'm rich and I'm just well and I believe in Jesus and everything's all right. But that's not the case. Amen. As Christians, we are constantly in lack. We're constantly in need of more of Jesus. We're constantly in need of a greater revelation of the Word of God. We're constantly in need of the power of the Spirit moving and operating in our lives. And in order for us to realize our lack, in order for us to realize that we're really not where we need to be, we're not really where we think we are. A lot of times the Holy Spirit, the Lord, He's going to cause and He's going to allow trials, tribulations, circumstances of life to literally overtake us. And those situations, those trials, those temptations, they're not meant to overtake us for our destruction. But they're meant to overtake us so that, number one, we will realize our lack, we'll realize our need, and number two, that we'll turn to Him in dependence upon Him, relying upon Him to provide for us that which we have need of. Yes. And at times when we begin to traverse through these trials, these temptations, these circumstances, a lot of times they can be so harsh, they can be so disheartening, they can be so heart-crushing that we get discouraged, that our faith wavers, our faith is tossed to and fro like the wind does the sea. A lot of times we get that way. But in the time of trial and the time of temptation, the Holy Spirit through the Apostle James here instructs us to do five things when we face these trials, these temptations of life. He tells us that we are to count, we are to know, we are to let, we are to ask, and we are to believe. These are not only opportunities that you and I are given, but they are as well responsibilities that the Holy Spirit lays upon the heart, upon the life of each and every believer as we traverse through trials and tribulations of this life. It is incumbent upon us as believers that if we are to travel through this process, as the Holy Spirit desires us to travel through it, it is incumbent upon us that we assume these responsibilities that the Holy Spirit has given unto us. It's incumbent upon us that we do such a thing. And I want to minister a message entitled this morning, The Making of a Man of God.
Amen.
Or you could say the making of a woman of God, but the making of a man of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, Lord, and we do so in the name of your Son, Jesus, Lord. Father, we thank you for this opportunity that you've given us, Lord, to stand before these your people, Lord. We ask, O God, that your Spirit would have free course in this place, Lord God. We fully realize, Lord, that in and of ourselves, Lord, we do not have the capability, Lord God, to have an effect, Lord God, on the hearts and the minds of your people, Lord God. And that's why we ask this morning for the power of your Spirit, Lord, to come, Lord, to move, Lord God, to motivate us, Lord God. Anoint my heart, Lord God. Anoint my mouth, Lord God, that I would speak forth your word with clarity and with truth, Lord God, that no violence would be done to your word this morning. And Father, anoint those of us, Lord God, who are hearing this morning. Lord, anoint our hearts to receive, Lord God, that which you would have for us to receive this morning, Lord. And we'll be sure when it's all said and done, as we do now, to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. And amen. Even though in the Word of God, in the New Testament, we don't have a lot of information about James, the half-brother of our Lord. We don't have much information about James, but the information that we do have is very strong, and it's very important that we understand who that James was in the beginning of the early church. It is believed that James wrote this epistle in the early AD 40s. It was around the time where the church had began to experience much persecution. They had come under attack of the enemy, and they began to experience persecution in their lives, and that's why James would address them as the Christian, the brethren who have been scattered abroad, because they were scattered because of the much persecution that had come to Jerusalem. But James, in writing this book, like I said, he's a very important role in the early church. He's a very interesting character. And that James, the half-brother of our Lord, he did not even believe in Jesus, even though he was his half-brother. But he did not even claim him nor believe him as the Messiah when Jesus was on this earth. Jesus would talk about that in his Gospels, how that his family and his brothers, they rejected him and they mocked him. So in his earthly ministry, the man whom we are reading behind this morning was not a believer in Jesus, mocked Jesus, much like the Apostle Paul. But the Apostle Paul would lay out something in the book of 1 Corinthians, and he would say how that after the resurrection, that Jesus would appear to his half-brother James and would reveal himself to James in some sort of way, form, or fashion. We're really not told exactly how it happened, but he would reveal himself to James, and James would give his heart and give his life to the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, that's a testimony of mercy and of grace. And I mean, what a testimony it is that the Lord would anoint James not only to lead the early church in Jerusalem, a church that numbered anywhere from 20 to 40,000 people. Not only would he anoint him and cause him to lead that church there, but that he would literally anoint him to be a pillar in the church. He would literally anoint him to write one of the greatest books that we find in the Word of God today. I mean, that's a testimony of mercy and of grace. A man who mocked Jesus, a man who did not believe in him as the Messiah, a man who did not claim him as Savior, a man who rejected him in all facets of his life, but after one experience giving his heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ changed him from the inside out and anointed him and used him to have one of the greatest impacts on Christianity that we know of today. That's a powerful testimony. It's believed, Jewish tradition tells us that James, that he was nicknamed Camel Knees because of the time that he spent on his knees in prayer. What a man that we have to read behind this morning. What a man of God that literally was known as Camel Knees because of the time that he spent in relationship on his knees with his Heavenly Father. And as I was thinking about that this morning, or yesterday, I don't remember. As I was thinking about that, I thought about the verse where Jesus said that he who is forgiven much loves much. And I think of James, how that the humility that was in the life of this man, that he, even though he was an apostle, he does not even address himself as an apostle in this epistle. He addresses himself simply as a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, as a bond slave of the Lord Jesus Christ, one who is connected to the Lord Jesus Christ to serve and to do as he pleases. And I thank God for the example of James this morning. And James would write his book really to Christian Jews, but really it pertains to all of us Christians today. But the reason for James writing this book is for spiritual growth and maturity. Much like Paul had to write to the church at Corinth, a church who was developed in their gifts, but they were lacking in their faith. They were developed in what they did and what they didn't do, but they were lacking in their maturity. So much like Paul had to write and correct and reprove the Corinthian church, so did James have to write and correct these early Christian believers because their faith, some way or another, was not properly placed where it ought to be. They were not seeing the growth that the Holy Spirit intended for them to see. They were not doing what the Holy Spirit intended for them to do. There were areas in their life that were lacking in maturity where they should have been well and grown up in the faith. They were still like babes sucking on a mother's breast. They were still weaning off of the mother's breast whenever they should have been fully mature, whenever they should have been walking in the knowledge of Jesus Christ and what He's done for us at the cross. See, a lot of times, there's a lot of differences, even though they do not contradict one another. But the way that Paul wrote and the way that James wrote, there are some differences there. Many times, the Apostle Paul would deal with the priority of faith. The priority that we must have faith, and not only faith, but that our faith would be anchored in its sole object of Jesus Christ and what He has done for us at Calvary's cross. But James here, in the book of James, deals with the proof of faith. Not only the priority of faith, because he knew that these Christians, that they had faith. He knew that their faith was strong. He knew that they had a living faith. But he said, if you have this faith that you claim you have, if you're living this Christian life that you claim you're living, then this is what should be resulting from your heart and life. You should not look like you did the first day that you got saved. You should not still be stagnant and not growing in the grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. You shouldn't look like what you looked like 2 months ago. Amen. You see, you and I are not supposed to look like we did a week ago, a month ago, a year ago. We're supposed to be continually being changed and transformed into the image of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And if our faith is misplaced, if our faith is not where it ought to be, then our growth will be and will remain stagnant. We will grow complacent. If our faith is not properly placed in Christ and what He has done for us at the cross, knowing and understanding that everything that we have need of comes to us by and through the Lord Jesus Christ, through His death at Calvary's cross. One commentator said it like this: without the perfect work of Christ, there could be no perfecting of the believer. So it's the Holy Spirit's desire that you be mature and that you be perfected. But without the work of Christ, without understanding that everything I receive from God comes by way of Christ and His shed blood at Calvary, without that understanding, then I will never see the growth that the Holy Spirit desires to see happen in my heart and in my life. In this passage in particular, the passage which we're dealing with today, James desires that the believers, that they have a proper perspective towards trials. And that's why he would go on in this passage to talk about trials. He wants us to know that trials, they're like a springboard to our faith. It's much, and he wants us to also know that trials and persecutions and temptations, that they should not be an unusual thing in the life of the believer. That it should not, when we go through trials, when we go through temptations, you know, a lot of times we get caught off guard and we say, my God, why is this happening? Why is this going on? And we want to blame the devil and we want to blame this person and that person and my aunt and my uncle. They did this and they did that. But the truth of the matter is as Christians, as born-again believers, we should expect for trials and tribulations and temptations to come upon us from time to time. And truth be told, it's not just time to time, but it seems like in my life it's just one thing after another. Amen. But it's a teaching process. Amen. It's not meant to destroy me.
Amen.
See, the thing is, and one commentator said it like this, Brother Schweiger said it like this, he said, faith must be tested. It must be. If you say that you have faith, then that faith from time to time must be put to the test. Oh, it's easy to stand up and say, I believe in Christ, I believe in the blood, you know, I believe in this Word of God, I believe this, and I go to church and I sing and I worship God. But that faith, if it is genuine, will be tested and will always pass the test.
Amen.
If it is genuine faith, then trial develops its persistence.
Amen.
If it is genuine faith. So faith must always be tested, and great faith must be tested greatly.
Amen.
You want great faith? Then get ready for the test. You want to be a man of God who touches the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ? You want to be seen of men singing and preaching and playing instruments and so on and so forth? You want to be used in the kingdom of God? Then get ready for the test.
Amen. Amen.
If you want to be used in the kingdom of God in any way, shape, form, or fashion, I'm not just talking about behind this pulpit. But I'm talking about in any way, shape, form, or fashion, if you desire to be used by God and you desire to follow the will of God, then get ready for the test.
Amen.
Because a good teacher doesn't just teach and send you on your way. A good teacher teaches and then puts you to the test.
Amen.
And the test is not for the teacher to see how much you've accomplished. The test is for you to see where you are lacking and how much further that you need to go.
Yes. Amen.
That's the reason for the test.
Yes.
The test is not given by God so that He can find out where you are in your walk with Him. He knows everything. He's omnipotent. He's omnipresent. He's omnipotent. He knows everything. He is everywhere. He knows our beginning from our end. He knows He is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. He knows all things. He is all things. He has all knowledge of all things.
Yes.
So it doesn't take God by surprise.
Amen.
Your lack of doubt, your lack of belief, that does not take God by surprise. But the Lord allows these things to come in our lives to show us where we are. And James would begin this passage in verse 1. He would say, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. And like we mentioned just a moment ago, when James talks about these believers being scattered abroad, they were scattered abroad because of the persecution that was coming in the church at that time. Acts chapter 8 and verse 1 says this, that at that time there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem. And they were scattered abroad throughout all the regions of Judea. So there was a great persecution at this time of James writing. There was a great persecution taking place against the church of Jesus Christ. And many times, I don't know if you'll agree with me or not, but I know this to be true. Many times, outward persecution can cause a deeper inward trial on the inside of us. I'm not saying that right. A lot of times, outward persecution, outward circumstances, outward trials, and outward physical situations that we face, circumstances, no matter what those situations might be, things that happen in the natural, many times they can affect our faith that lies on the inside of us. And that's why James is, he's not just writing because they're facing physical persecution, but he's writing because he knows that in the midst of this persecution, there's doubt, there's fear, there's anxiety. So he writes to the church to encourage them to count it all joy in the midst of trial and temptation. So in verse 2, James tells the brethren, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. That's an easy scripture to read, but it's not very easy to live.
Amen.
Everybody said amen.
Amen.
Count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation. That word count there literally means to have a made up mind. To have a mindset that is set and is planted.
Amen.
To have an attitude that is not deterred, that is not pushed to the left or to the right, but to have a particular mindset that cannot be changed. So he's telling us to count it all. All means every single piece.
Yes.
Every single trial, every single circumstance, every single situation, no matter how despairing it may look in the natural, he tells us to count it all joy. The idea is to reckon everything that we face in this life as joy. Well, my bills need to be paid, joy. Well, I just lost my job, joy. Well, my spouse, they're not on the same page as me, joy. Well, I'm facing this situation at work and in school and so on, joy. Well, I just lost a family member, joy. You say, well, that's crazy. No, that's not crazy. James says to count it all joy.
Amen.
Every single piece of the puzzle, you're to count it all joy when you face it in this life. That word fall there, when you fall into diverse temptations, it literally means to fall into something like a pit. It takes you by surprise. You just fall, and you fall deep into this thing. And diverse, of course, we know what that means. Various kinds, colors, many different kinds. And we've got to understand something, that not all trials are going to be the same. Not all temptations, not all situations that come our way are going to be the same. I know a lot of times I'll be in prayer, or not just in prayer, just thinking throughout my day, and I'll begin to think of, you know, I've just come out of a certain trial, and I'll begin to think of the next trial that the Lord has for me. I know that sounds kind of crazy, but the thing is, you know it's coming.
Yeah.
So, you know, you start to formulate in your mind, you know, how can I be prepared for this thing? How am I going to be able to so on and so forth and this, that, and the other? And then the trial that you end up facing, it not only comes when you least expect it,
amen,
but it's nowhere near what you formulated in your mind that it was going to be.
Amen.
And most of the time, it's far more severe. It's far more disheartening. It's far more crushing than what you could have imagined or thought of in your mind. It takes you by surprise.
Amen.
Even though Peter says it shouldn't, because we should know that it's not a strange thing that we go through trial and temptations. It shouldn't take us by surprise. But when these things come upon us, they do take us by surprise, because we're not really as prepared as we thought we were.
Amen.
I know a lot of times it seems like right before I go through a trial, the Lord will begin to do something special in my heart. And He'll begin to reveal things to me, or speak things to me, or whatever the case. And just a few months ago, I'll give this example. A few months ago, I was in a service one Sunday morning at Family Worship Center. And the Spirit of God moved mightily in the service. And the Lord just did a mighty, mighty work in my heart that morning. And any time that the Spirit of God moves upon your heart in a unique way, in a special way, in a powerful way, it's not just for no reason. It's not just for happen chance. He's wanting to do something in you. He's wanting to speak something to you. He desires to show you something, to reveal something to you. And that Sunday morning, there were some particular things in my heart that I began to pray about, and I began to take authority over in prayer, and I just began to pray and seek the face of God, and kind of went about my business for a couple of days, a few weeks, and then just out of nowhere, bam, one thing after another in my life just kept going and unfolding and going and unfolding, and not really understanding what was going on, and very discouraged, very disheartened. I thought about what the Lord had laid on my heart just a few weeks before. And you see, what the Lord was doing is He was preparing me to go through that which I was about to go through. You see, the Lord, He's never going to bring you into something or allow something to come upon your life that you're not prepared to face, that you're not prepared to face head on. Now, in your strength and in your ability, you are unprepared.
Amen.
You don't have what it takes to face the trial as you ought to face it in and of yourself. But if you'll rely upon the Spirit of God and on the Word of God, He'll do in you what you cannot do for yourself.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
God, He uses these trials and these temptations,
yes,
like I'm speaking of. He uses them to expose to us the quality of our faith. You see, trials and temptations, they come and go. But the one thing that is to stay constant, the one thing that is to remain, is the fact that we continue to count it all joy.
Amen.
See, trials, they will come and go. Trials, they will be different. They will be various. They will be diverse. Sometimes they'll be more excruciating, more painful than others. They're going to come and go. They're going to change. But the one thing that must remain in the midst of trial and in the midst of temptation, in the midst of the process of God, the one thing that is to remain is that we are to count it all joy. Because we know that the end result will far, the glory of the end result is going to far outweigh the pain and the suffering and the trial that we are enduring and facing right now.
Amen.
The glory of the end result of this thing will turn out for your good.
Amen.
And one commentator said it like this, and I love this quote. He said, if we value comfort more than character, then trials will upset us. If we value the material and physical more than the spiritual, we will not be able to count it all joy. If we live only for the present and forget the future, then trials will make us bitter and not better. So James is encouraging us to count it all joy. Because if you realize what God is trying to do in you and through you, then this thing's not going to destroy you. It's not going to upset you. It's not going to get you disoriented. And in verse 3, he says this. You see, James doesn't just tell us to do something without giving us the reason for doing it. He tells us to count it all joy when we fall into diverse temptations. And here's the reason why. Because we know this, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. So the reason for which I am to count it all joy, James tells me, is because the trying of my faith is working patience within me. The trying of my faith, it's working patience. So he tells us not only to count it all joy, but he tells us that we need to know something. That in order for us to count it all joy, we've got to know why we're counting it all joy. And that knowing there, it's not something that you just wake up one morning and you know in your mind. It's an experiential knowledge. As we traverse through these trials, these temptations of life, as we experience these trials, we're going to find that we're going to come to the knowledge the more and more God brings us through these things, the more and more God gives us victory over these areas of our life, the more and more God comes through for us in these trials and these situations and these temptations, we're going to gain a knowledge that what the Lord is trying to do in me is something special. You see, a lot of times we think of that word patience and we think of, you know, in today's vernacular, we just think of it, you know, like my wife telling me, babe, you need to be patient. Because I'm a very impatient person. I hate to admit it, but I am. I'm just ready to go, go, go. And you know, we got kids and this and bags and toys and this and everything else that we got to deal with before we leave the house. I'm telling you, it takes us 30, 40 minutes just to get out the door every time we go somewhere. And I get impatient. And a lot of times we think of patience as that. We think of, well, you just need to be patient. You just need to slow down a little bit. You need to wait. And there's a sense of that in this verse here. But really, what the Holy Spirit is telling us, that word patience, it literally means to remain under. It really means endurance, steadfastness, constancy. So what James is telling us here is that the trying of our faith, we need to know something. And what we need to know is that what we are experiencing now is literally causing us to have an endurance as it regards our faith that we have not had in the past. What we are, and I said that word patience, I said it means to come under, to remain under something. And what that means is that we are coming under, that we are remaining under the process of God. Because let me tell you this, the process of God, in order for you to be changed, in order for you to be molded and shaped into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ, His process is that you go through trial and tribulation to see your lack and to see your need for Him. So James is telling us, don't come out of this thing. Know this, that the trying of your faith is going to give you a greater endurance, a greater steadfastness to stay under, to remain in the process that God has designed for you.
Good.
And it wasn't just only James who gave us this description. Paul would tell us the same thing in Romans chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. He begins to talk about justification by faith, Paul did. In Romans chapter 5, verse 1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And not only do we have peace, but we have access by grace into this faith, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And then Paul goes on to say that after we understand our justification, immediately we enter into our walk with the Lord. We enter into sanctification. And trials begin to come. Let's turn there for just a moment. Romans chapter 5. Because I want to show you the similarity here. Romans chapter 5. Beginning in verse 3. Just three verses here. Romans chapter 5, beginning in verse 3. He says this. So not only do we realize and know that we're justified by faith, not only do we realize and know that we have access to God by the same faith, but we know this also. Verse 3, chapter 5 of Romans. And not only so, but we glory in tribulation. You see what he says? James tells us to count it all joy in tribulation, and Paul says that we literally glory in tribulation. Why, Paul? Knowing this, that tribulation works patience. There again is the Holy Spirit telling us that tribulation and trial, it works patience and endurance and steadfastness within us. Listen, I read this definition a while back of patience in the New Testament. Patience is the New Testament characteristic of a man who is not swerved from his deliberate purpose and his loyalty to faith and piety by even the greatest trials and sufferings. I want to read that again. The New Testament characteristic of a man who is not swerved from his deliberate purpose and his loyalty to faith by even the greatest trials and sufferings. So what the Holy Spirit is desiring to work in you and I is this endurance. That even in the face of the utmost opposition, the utmost trial, the utmost situations that come our way, that our faith is not swerved. Our faith is not deterred. Our faith is not moved from the place where it ought to be in Jesus Christ and what he's done at the cross. And Paul would take it a step further. Back in Romans 5, he would say, not only does tribulation work patience, but patience works experience. And experience works hope. And hope makes not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. So the Apostle Paul tells us, just as did James, that these tribulations, they're going to work for our good. That what these tribulations are doing in us, by giving us endurance, by giving us patience, by giving us a steadfast faith, that they're eventually going to bring glory to God. So I can be encouraged today that the situation that I'm facing, in some way, shape, form, or fashion, God is going to get the glory out of what I'm going through right now. I don't know how it can happen. I don't understand in my natural mind how it's going to happen. But I have to believe from the very depth of my soul that some kind of way, God's going to get the glory out of what I'm facing right now. Some of you just need to encourage yourself this morning that it doesn't matter what's going on in my life. It doesn't matter how bad they've come against me. It doesn't matter all the hell, excuse my vernacular, that is breaking loose in my life. It does not matter one way or another. The Son of God, the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, is going to be glorified in my life. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. God will get glory out of your life if you allow him to do in you what he desires to do. Your job and your priority is to not quit in the midst of trial. Your job is to not give up in the midst of temptation. Amen. Your job is to not stop believing in the midst of hell itself coming against your life and coming against your family. Yes. Your job is to keep believing, to keep pushing forward. Paul said, I forget those things which are behind, and I press forward toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Your job is to believe God and to continue going forward.
Amen.
The enemy
Amen.
Wants you to retreat, but God, the Holy Ghost, is saying go forward.
Yeah.
The enemy wants you to stop, but the Holy Spirit is telling you to keep going forward.
Amen.
And remember this, that the enemy, the devil, can only do to you that which God allows him to do in your life.
Yes.
The enemy does not have free course over your life and over your heart. Every situation that you face in your life, if you are a born-again, blood-bought child of God, every situation, every trial that you face is either caused or allowed by the Lord. The devil, the enemy, powers of darkness and demons of hell cannot do to you only but what the Holy Ghost allows him or them to do to you.
Yeah.
Satan came to God and he said, God, if you allow me to test Job, he'll give up on you, he'll quit, he'll stop believing. And the Lord told Satan, he said, I've got a hedge built all the way around Job, and you cannot touch him unless I allow you to touch him. And I'm here to tell you this morning, that's not just for Job, but every person whose faith is in Christ and what he's done at the cross. You have a hedge built all the way around you, and you cannot fail the Lord. There's nothing that the enemy can do to you that he does not allow him to do. And even when God allows Satan to come against you and bring trial and suffering and temptation, it's not for your destruction, but it's for your good. And some kind of way, you'll be able to stand up after the trial and say, God is going to get some glory out of my situation. I don't know how, and I don't know when I'm facing things right now. I don't know when God's going to come through. I don't know how it's going to work out, but I'm saying, God, in the midst of this, I believe you. In the midst of this, I'll praise you. In the midst of this, I'll worship you. In the midst of this, I'll get on my knees and say, thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah to the Lamb. I cannot stop praising him. He's brought me too far for me to look back now. I will not stop. I will not quit. Go ahead. Turn the fire up as hot as you want to get it. But I refuse to quit because he's brought me too far to be deterred and to quit right now. I will not stop. He's brought me too far to turn around now. There's a hedge built all the way around me. Devil, do what you will, but God is going to get the glory out of my life.
Amen.
Satan, do what you desire to do, but God's going to get the glory out of my life.
Hallelujah.
God will get the glory out of my life. Satan's tried to kill me. He's trying to kill me, trying to destroy me, trying to deter me, trying to get me to stop believing. But I refuse to quit right now because I know that the Holy Ghost is up to something special in my life. I know that the power of God is about to show up and about to shake every kingdom of Satan loose in my life. I declare it right now in the name of Jesus that every stronghold, every bondage that the enemy has thrown against you and your family, I declare it broken right now in the name of Jesus. Sometimes you just need to speak to the mountain that stands before you. Sometimes you just need to prophesy to the mountain of doubt that stands before you and tell that mountain, mountain, get out of my way in the name of Jesus. Sometimes you just got to take authority in the name of Jesus. You've got to take authority. Jesus told his disciples, you have authority over every serpent, over every power of the devil. You have authority today in the name of Jesus. And though it may seem like Satan is having his free course in your heart and in your life, I'm here to tell you that God is going to come through if you simply will not quit believing. You have to believe. You have to keep on placing your faith in Christ and what he's done at the cross. You say, well, I failed God in the midst of it. Get back up. Paul said in Hebrews chapter 12, he said, strengthen the feeble knees and lift up the hands which hang down. Get back up from your failure and begin to praise God in the midst of your circumstance. See, sometimes we just want to remain remain silent and not say, but I'm telling you, there's something powerful that happens when you begin to speak the word of God. There's something powerful that takes place when you begin to say the name of Jesus, when you begin to proclaim the name of Jesus, when you begin to proclaim that He's glorious and He's mighty and He's wondrous and He's a strong and mighty tower and His name is mighty to save. There's something that happens in the spirit realm when you begin to take authority over every principality that has come against your life. Don't just sit there silent waiting for God to do something. Stand upon your feet, lift your hands, and begin to worship the one who's allowing you to go through what you're going through. I know it's not easy, I know. You say, well, you're a young preacher, you don't know much. Well, I may not know much, but I know a little bit.
Amen.
I'm not claiming to know very much. I'm not claiming to have arrived at anything. I'm not claiming to do this thing perfectly because God knows that I don't. And like I said last time, don't even talk to my wife about it. Don't even ask her about what I can or can't do because she's got some stories to tell you that I don't want any of y'all to hear. But you got some stories too.
Amen.
That there ain't not a soul in this world you want to know about you.
Amen.
But we're to count it all joy when we face these temptations. Amen. Paul would tell us in verse 4. So he tells us to count. He tells us to know. And now he commands us. He doesn't suggest us. He commands us to let. But let patience, in verse 4, but let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Like I said, that word let, it's a command, it's not a suggestion. Going back to what Paul said in Romans chapter 5, you see, patience works in us to complete us. Because as Paul said, patience works experience, and experience works hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. You know, as like we talked about at the beginning, James wrote this epistle to see spiritual growth and maturity take place in the church. And many times we think of wisdom, or we think of maturity or growth coming with age. And there's a sense of that is true. But let me tell you something. There are young people in the church today who have grabbed a hold of this word of God,
yeah,
and who have placed their faith in Christ and what He's done at the cross, who are just as mature, if not more mature, than some believers who have been sitting in church for 30, 40, 50 years. Why? Because they've grabbed a hold of the truth. They've placed their faith in Christ and what He's done at the cross. They realize that they can receive nothing from God except it come by the way of the cross. They've grabbed a hold of this great message of the cross. So wisdom and maturity and spiritual growth, it doesn't always come with age. And a lot of times, old Pentecostal preachers will say, well, that young man, he just doesn't know what I know. He can't do what I do because he's not as old as I am. But let me tell you something. There's a generation of believers that God's raising up right now.
Amen.
Like the song says, there's an army that's rising up right now. I believe it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That there's an army all over this world. They may not look right. They may not fit the so-called bill. They may not be up in age. But let me tell you something. They're full of faith.
Amen.
And they're full of the power of Almighty God.
Amen.
And God right now, I believe, is bringing them through the test. Bringing them through the wilderness.
Yes.
So that they can be men and women of God that He desires for them to be.
Hallelujah.
Verse 4. But let patience have her perfect work. Like we were saying, we're to allow patience to do this. And really, we can only do this by faith. It's only the power of the Spirit that can allow us to let patience to have her perfect work. That you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. That word perfect there, it literally means brought to a completed end. Like I was saying just a moment ago, what James is focusing on here is not, I want you to get this, it's not sinless perfection in our everyday life and living that James is talking about, us being brought to perfection, us being brought to maturity, lacking nothing, wanting nothing. It's our faith that James is identifying here. It's our faith being brought to its maturity. It's our faith being brought to an endurance and a steadfastness that we've never known before. And I love that phrase where he says that we may be perfect and entire, perfect and complete, wanting nothing. When I think of that phrase, wanting nothing, I think of Psalms 23. And if you can, let's turn there for just a moment. Psalm 23.
Amen.
I was thinking about this morning, and really this didn't come to my mind until this morning, but reading this verse, it rolled all over my spirit this morning. When everyone knows Psalm 23. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. What does that mean? When I realize that my heavenly shepherd, no matter my outward circumstance, no matter my outward situation, when the Holy Spirit finally brings me to the realization that my heavenly shepherd has in store for me the utmost best, that no matter what befalls my life, be it negative, be it great, be it good, be it bad, whatever the case, whatever befalls my life, when I come to the realization that my shepherd knows best, that whether he's chastising me or he's comforting me, that my shepherd knows best. Whether I'm facing the trial or whether I'm sitting on the mountaintop, in the valley or in the mountaintop, in the shadow of darkness or in a place of light, no matter where I am in this life, when I come to the place that I finally realize that my shepherd, my heavenly shepherd, knows best, then I could finally rest in the fact of knowing that there is nothing that I have need of that he has not already provided for me at Calvary's cross.
Amen.
And maybe
Amen.
I don't see it happening in my life right now. Maybe I don't see it coming to pass right now. But I rest in the fact that I know that he's going to provide for me that which I have need of. That there's nothing outside of his covenant that he hasn't provided for me what I need. Everything that I need has already been provided for me by my heavenly shepherd.
Amen.
Paul said that everything that we need has been provided to us through our Lord Jesus Christ. That God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. You see, this is part of the process. The Holy Spirit is trying to get you to the place to where you realize that there's nothing of this earth, there's nothing of this world that you need outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ, outside of what he can give to you, outside of what he can provide for you. We seek this and we seek for that and all these things, and we want good and we want this and we want that, and there's nothing wrong with all that. But if all that takes the place of our relationship with our heavenly shepherd, then we've fallen apart. We're missing it somewhere.
Amen.
Jesus said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness."
Amen.
"And then all these things shall be added Amen. Unto you."
Amen.
You know what most of us do? And I'm guilty of this. I've done it. And I'll probably still do it. But we read that verse backwards. We say, well, I'm going to get all that I want and all that I need if I just seek Jesus first and I just do what he wants me to do. That's not what he's telling us. He's telling us, seek me, seek my righteousness, seek my will, seek my purpose, seek what I am trying to do in your heart and in your life. Ask me for what I'm trying to do. Seek me for what I'm desiring to do. Knock, and I'm going to open for you the doors that no man can open.
Yes, man.
And then I'll take care of all the rest.
Yes, Jesus.
You don't even worry about all the rest of it. Just give me your life. Seek after me. Follow after me. Pursue after me. Run after me. And I'll take care of everything else that you face and every other situation that's going on in your life. Seek me first. Put me first. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. You see, this is what we're learning in the process. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for His name's sake.
Yes, Lord.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. He's going to give you what you need in the midst of the trial.
Yes, Lord.
He's going to give you what you need in the midst of the trial. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely, surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. David learned something of God. David learned something. That through the valley of the shadow of death, that through being in the presence of his enemies, through going through trial and tribulation and circumstance and failure after failure, he learned something. That the goodness and mercy of God was following him all the days of his life.
Amen.
That's what the Lord, that's what the Holy Spirit is trying to teach you and I in this process today. Is that what we're facing, what we're going through, it's not meant for our harm or our destruction.
Amen.
It's meant for goodness and mercy to have its way, to have its rightful place in our hearts and in our lives. That's why Jesus said, when you pray, pray like this. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We start off prayer by praising the name of Jesus, by hallowing his name. He didn't give us that prayer in a formulative sense, meaning get on your knees and pray these exact same words, this exact same way. No, the prayer was given to us as a pattern to show us how we ought to pray. So I come before the Father and I pray, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Lord, I praise your name. I thank you that you're my righteousness. I thank you that you're Jehovah Jireh, my provider. I thank you that that you're Jehovah Nissi, my victory. I thank you that you're everything that I'll ever have need of. I thank you for the covenant that you established at Calvary's cross. I thank you for the blood that was shed at Calvary. I thank you that I'm an heir of the kingdom of God. I thank you that I'm a child of the Most High God. I thank you that goodness and mercy is going to follow me all the days of my life. And then he said, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done. That's what Jesus told us to pray. Lord, let your kingdom come and let it be established in our hearts and in our lives. Let that which you have ordained in heaven come and manifest itself in my heart and in my life. See, this is the way we ought to pray. This is the way we ought to seek our Heavenly Father. Lord, that you would have your perfect way, that you would have your perfect will in my heart and in my life. Lord, that your kingdom would come, your power, your rule, and your reign would establish itself in my heart and in my life. And let me tell you something, when we get serious about seeking after the kingdom of God, when we get serious about staying under, remaining under the process that God has for us, then the enemy gets serious about opposing us. So the trial that comes, and the reason I said how we ought to pray is like I was going back to saying, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. When we begin to seek God for His will and for His way to be accomplished in our hearts and in our lives, the enemy will come. You see, trials, they come in many different ways, shape, forms, fashion. It can be trials from the outward. People have hurt us. People have wronged us. The powers of darkness opposing us in ways that we've not known before. But many times the worst trials is that which goes on the inside of us.
Amen.
The lack that we see, the doubt that we see, the fear, the anxiety that grips our hearts at times. And it's hard to see our way through those things. But going back to James in verse 5, and I'm closing in just a moment. James chapter 1, verse 5, he says this, that in the midst of the fear, the anxiety, we're to do another thing. We're to, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. And really that word if should have been translated since. It should have been translated since you lack wisdom. Ask of God and he's going to give unto you liberally. And that word wisdom there, it means experienced knowledge. Knowledge that has been put to the test. See, like I said at the beginning, a lot of times we can have this knowledge of the message of Christ and him crucified. We can have a knowledge of the Word of God in our minds. But it's going to have to be put to the test in order for that knowledge to drop from here to here. Because God doesn't want that knowledge just to remain a head knowledge, something you quote off of your lips, off of your tongue, something you can say. Every one of us can talk about the message of the cross. We can say the message of the cross. We can say my faith is placed in Christ and what he's done at the cross. But is your life reflecting what is coming out of your mouth? Is your life, is your heart and your life reflecting what's coming out of your mouth? Is it reflecting that? Is your life being lived in the confines of Christ and what he's done at the cross? James asks us whether that's true or whether it's not. When you face the trial and the temptation, you need to ask God for wisdom. Why does he identify wisdom here? And I really don't have, I wouldn't say a definite answer for this. Because there are so many things that James could have told us to ask for here. But I believe he tells us to ask for wisdom in one sense, that we not take advantage, that we not waste the opportunities that God is giving us to learn something, to grow and to mature. Because every time that the Lord allows these things to happen, like we've been talking about, every time he allows the trial, the temptation to come, it's for a purpose. And we need to ask God for wisdom. Lord, don't allow me to waste the opportunity that you're giving me to grow, to mature, to learn something. Because every time he's allowing something, he's trying to show you something. He's trying to teach you something. It's been said, and I believe it with all my heart, that desperation precedes revelation. That God is going to get you desperate in order that you would begin to seek his face and cry out for his will to be accomplished in your heart and in your life. He wants to get us desperate. He's not pleased with us being complacent. He's not pleased with us being stagnant in our walk with him. So he'll allow the trial to come that we'll fall on our face and say, God, I see my lack. Lord, I see my need, Lord, and I ask you for wisdom to have its way in my heart and in my life. I ask for your spirit to come and have its rule and its reign in my heart and in my life. Jesus taught this very same thing throughout the gospel. After he taught the Lord's Prayer in Luke chapter 11, and I'm closing in just a moment, I promise. But after he taught the Lord's Prayer in Luke 11, he gave the parable of the three loaves. And he talked about how that the man came to his neighbor at midnight, the worst time of night to go next door, to go to your neighbor's house. In the middle of the night, everyone's asleep. Everyone's asleep, everyone's in bed. And he comes to his neighbor's house and he begins to knock on the door. And he said, there's someone who's come to my house and I need to provide for him food. I don't have any food. I don't have any sustenance to provide for him. And the man said, get out of here. Go away. Come back tomorrow and I'll give you what you need. He said, all my children are asleep. My wife is asleep. We're in bed. The door's locked and I'm not coming to the door. But he began to knock again. And the man said, please go away. I'll come tomorrow and I'll give you what you need. But the neighbor, he insisted. He said, I've got to have what I need right now. And he would not quit knocking until that man came to the door and gave him what he needed. You see, that word, when he tells us to ask for wisdom, it doesn't mean just to ask one time and then quit. It means that you ask and you keep on asking. You seek and you keep on seeking. You knock and you keep on knocking until the Lord shows you what He's trying to do in you. You ask Him, Lord, what are you trying to do? And if you don't get an answer, you seek and you seek out. You turn over every possibility and you say, God, show me what you're trying to do. Show me your will for my life. Give me direction. Give me that which I have to have right now in my heart and in my life.
Show me my heart.
And knock. You ask, you seek, you knock, and you continue over and over and over and over again. You agitate Him to the point to where that He's going to give you what you need. Sometimes the answer will be no. Sometimes the answer will not be what you want it to be. But regardless of that, He will give you wisdom to traverse through the situation and the trial that you're presently facing right now. He will give you what you need to traverse through what you're going through. And in verse 6, and I'm closing right now. And in verse 6, James tells us that when we ask, that God, that He's going to give it to us, like we just said. He's going to give it to us liberally. That literally means that He's going to give and keep on giving. It's going to keep coming down. And upbraideth not and shall be given. But let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering, nothing doubting. For he that doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Let him ask in faith. That's a complete trust in one's heart. And that word wavering, doubting there, it literally means to make a judgment based on an external evaluation. So when we look at the trial and we look at the situation and we judge it according to only that which we can see, then that's doubt, that's fear, that's wavering in our faith. But James says the Holy Spirit's trying to remove that out of you.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is trying to give you a constant faith. A faith that endures, a faith that is steadfast, that is not moved in the midst of your trial and in the midst of your circumstance. He's telling us not to come to a conclusion based on only what we can see. You know, I think a good example of that is Numbers chapter 13, whenever the Lord sent the 12 spies into the promised land. And the Bible says that 10 of those spies came back. They came back with fruit of the land, and they came back with all this good stuff of the land. But yet when they seen the giants, the Bible says that they feared, and that they told the people of Israel, we cannot go into the land that God's promised us. But there were two men by the name of Joshua and Caleb, who, in spite of what they seen in the natural, said, we are well able to go up and to take the country. I'm telling you, in spite of your external, what you can see with your natural eye, in spite of those circumstances, you're well able to go up and take the country that God's promised you and that God's assured you. And in this process, if we're going to make it, as the Holy Spirit desires us to, if we're to remain under this process of being shaped and molded into the image of Christ, if we're going to endure the process of chastening, if we're going to endure the process of being changed, then we're going to need to count, to know, to let, to ask, and to believe. I believe one of the greatest examples of that is Job. And Job told us that He knows the way I take, and when He has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. And you see, that's the end. That's the end that the Holy Spirit is desiring to bring us to. Is that no matter what we're facing, we can stand up and say, He knows the way I take. He knows where I am. Even though I can't see Him, Job said. Even though I cannot behold Him on my left or on my right, even though I cannot see or understand what He's doing in me right now, I know and I believe that He knows the way that I take. And when He has tried me, when the trying of my faith is complete, I will come forth as pure gold. There's an old song that was written in the early 1900s, I believe, entitled Job's God is True. And it's become, honestly, one of my favorite songs. And the song, it says, I can feel the hand of Satan as the tempter pressed me sore. He has been before the Father asking leave to tempt me more. I can hear the Father grant it, saying, do not touch his life. Though you crush him, he'll not falter. He will rise above the strife. And then the chorus says, though God slay me, yet will I trust him. I shall then come forth as gold. For I know my Savior liveth, for I feel him in my soul. And then that second verse said, when I look all about me, and his face I cannot see. Maybe you can't see his face this morning. Let's stand together this morning. Maybe you say, I cannot see his face in this trial. I cannot understand how good can come about what I'm going through right now. I don't understand how God can get the glory out of what I'm facing and what I'm going through. That second line said, when I look all about me in his face I cannot see, then I know that through the lattice he beholdeth even me. Even though I cannot see him and I can't understand what's going on, I cannot see how he can get the glory out of what I'm going through. I know that he's working something special within me. And I just want the devil to know this morning that when I come forth from this thing, and I want you to tell the devil this morning, when I come forth from this thing that I'm facing, when I come forth from this trial, this testing, this temptation, this thing that has seemingly overtaken me. And you say, I don't understand it. I want you to tell the devil this morning, the Lord is going to get the glory.